Okay, let's get started. Welcome to our webinar on our quarterly trends in the trading of futures and options worldwide. Just as a reminder for all of you, we're going to record this webinar and post it to our website within 24 hours. And I'm very much hoping that you'll ask questions as you go along, and we'll do our best to answer them both in during the webinar and then at the end. So this is our quarterly webinar on trading trends in the global futures and options markets. Very excited to have you all here. And I'm especially excited to have a guest speaker who brings an incredible amount of expertise on commodity markets. That's Guy Wolf, Global Head of Market Analytics at Marex. Guy has been analyzing futures and options markets for roughly 20 years. Over that time, he's developed some really innovative tools for mining market data, for insights on liquidity and the positioning of various market players. And I think we'll be getting a glimpse of some of those tools during the course of this webinar. For those of you who don't know, Marex is one of the leading independent brokers for futures and options in the world. It's especially strong in the commodity markets, and that's been bolstered by a string of acquisitions in recent years, including Rosenthal Collins in the US, and EDF and Man Capital Markets, as well as several others. So Guy really has his a finger on the pulse of quite an extraordinary range of commodity markets around the world. Guy, welcome to our show.
Thanks, Will. Thanks for the invite. Glad to be here.
So I'm going to try to cover a lot of ground in the next 40, 45 minutes or so. We'll start off with an overview, just looking at the kind of the big picture, what's happened to the global volume and open interest trends. Then we'll get into what's happening with interest rate and equity contracts. And then we'll spend the rest of the time talking about commodity markets and really diving into some of the really interesting trends in that area. So first, briefly, just what are we talking about here? The data we're talking about comes from the monthly data collection that we do here at FIA. We're looking at volume and open interest based on the number of contracts. And we actually publish that data in a monthly report, which anyone who is a member of FIA can obtain just by contacting us at data@fia.org. We also publish this data in the form of visualizations on the website. Those are accessible to absolutely anyone. And the great thing about them is that they're interactive, which means you can choose which region or which asset class or which type of contract you'd like to see. Check it out. It's on our website. Right. So what's the overview? Well, it's kind of a situation where we have some numbers pointing up very dramatically and others not changing at all. So you can see on this slide very quickly, options trading volume has skyrocketed compared to the first quarter of 2022. Futures, on the other hand, is roughly unchanged. And then you look at by regions, kind of the same story. Asia Pacific skyrocketing, other regions not so much. And we're going to see why here when we look at the next slide, which shows the breakdown by different types of commodities. So we're seeing a tremendous increase in the volume in equity contracts in Asia Pacific, and specifically in options. And we'll see why here on the next slide. So that's now looking back over 5 years, what's been the trend over the last 5 years? One quarter after another of record volume, which is really impressive, except as you can see, it's pretty much concentrated in that orange bar, which represents Asia Pacific. I should add, by the way, it's not entirely there. It's a little bit harder to see, but that light blue bar, which is North America, that's actually been growing quite well. And if it wasn't for this extraordinary growth in Asia Pacific, we'd all be celebrating an amazing rate of growth in North America. So what is driving that growth? Well, the number one factor, and it really overwhelms almost everything else, is the National Stock Exchange of India. This chart is showing just the volume in the top three equity index options listed on NSE India. And that curve, that growth rate is just unprecedented in my 20 years of looking at these markets. The only thing that even comes close was the growth in the KOSPI 200 index options years and years ago, but this is overwhelming even that. It's really been an amazing rate of growth, and it makes us all wonder why. So all I can say about this, really, because I can't say I'm an expert on that market, is here is a breakdown of the market composition. This comes directly from a report that NSE puts out, I think, each month that covers all of the markets they offer. And what you see here right away is that there are two segments that are dominating that trade, that kind of volume. First, the sort of the darker blue bar are the proprietary traders, which includes lots of different types of firms. Then the second, that yellowish orange, is the retail trading. So and there's only a small part, but it's not zero, small part that's coming from outside India. So this is a market phenomenon that is driven primarily by developments inside India. And I hard to say exactly what it is, but it's something we'll be looking at in much more detail in coming webinars. Now, what about open interest? This is actually pretty, or maybe even more important to many of the people on this call, as you know, because this is really where people are holding that risk and keeping it over time. And here what we see is that actually the first quarter on a global basis, we actually hit a record. It was just slightly above the third quarter of 2022, around 1.17 billion contracts. And we're going to talk about that a lot more as we go on. That's actually quite a positive dimension because that means clients are actually adding to the risk positions in their accounts. Now, I talked there about what was happening in India. One of the obvious factors there is there's a tremendous amount of retail participation. And that may be of interest to lots of different kinds of market participants, but I know that many of you care much more about what's happening on the institutional side. And so I've been thinking about this for a while. How do we untangle institutional trading from retail trading? We see the same issue in the United States. We see a tremendous amount of retail trading in recent years. And so you wonder, well, okay, how much of the overall growth is coming from that side of the market versus institutional? So what we've done here at FIA is we've developed two indices that are designed to be used sort of as proxies for tracking institutional trading. We can't really go to the exchange and say, please unbundle that, or the brokers. What we can do is say, which contracts, which futures, which options tend to be used primarily by institutional users. By institutional, what do I mean? I'm talking about hedge funds, asset managers, insurance companies, commodity merchants, commercial end users, those people that are mostly looking at this for either some kind of investment exposure or risk management, i.e. hedging. So the next slide shows, all right, so if we took that subset and then tracked growth of trading in that subset, how has it done over time? So first, the core, which is about 47 contracts, what we see is that there was a big peak in March of 2020, as you'd expect, onset of the pandemic, tremendous U-turn across all the markets, lots of repositioning. And then we saw, you know, level of trading activity kind of go back to where it had been, but then slowly start to rise over 2022. And then finally in March of this year, a big surge in both the core index and the broad index, which is related mainly to that tremendous surge in trading of interest rate futures and options because of all that uncertainty we saw in the kind of interest rate sector, particularly with the failures of, let's see, Silicon Valley Bank, Signature Bank, and I know there's at least one other one, which caused a lot of uncertainty about the sort of the economic outlook and particularly interest rate outlook. So this is an index that we intend to publish going forward. More than happy to share more information about it as we go forward. It's very much a work in progress, and I'm hoping those of you can give us some feedback. This is the rough composition. So you can see it covers four different asset classes, all three regions, 47 contracts in the first one, 100 in the other. Again, happy to talk about that more if people have questions. Now, just very briefly, exchange ranking. This is a helpful slide for those of you who are trying to understand what's happening at that level. Again, NSE is way up at the top because of that tremendous growth. You also see a lot of growth in some of the Chinese exchanges if you get down to line 7. Not that much growth in the sort of more the exchanges we know and love so well, which are kind of at the core of our markets. The next slide shows the same story. One thing I do need to emphasize is you see that Miami and TMX, just like NASDAQ and ICE in the previous page, the open interest in those exchanges does not include does not include the equity options that are traded on those exchanges, but are cleared through the Options Clearing Corporation. So that's why you see Miami being such a tiny amount of open interest. In reality, that's because most of that open interest is sitting over at the OCC. And what you're seeing there is just a bit of the futures trading on what used to be known as the Minneapolis Grain Exchange. All right, so I wanted to start now to go through some of the financials. First, equity index volume by region. On the left-hand side is the futures. On the right-hand side, the options. We already know the story on the options side. That's the NSC just absolutely seeing incredible rate of growth. On the futures side, that's mainly driven by B3 of Brazil. We saw a tremendous rise up to about 2021, then came back down in a bit. There's an amazing story there that I've talked about in previous webinars, essentially a sort of generational shift in investor behavior, but it's not entirely retail. Retail is certainly a big driver. There's also lots of institutional trading, portfolio investors that are now finding that the efficient way to add Brazil exposure to the portfolios is through the futures contracts there, or alternatively, intermediaries that are perhaps hedging or making markets in offshore products are using B3 to kind of recycle that risk. Now, what else? Equity index top contracts by volume. There's a lot of information packed into the slide. I'm not sure exactly how to unpack this, but I guess the top thing from here is that first, India, top three, as we sort of expect. But you notice the open interest isn't very large, by the way. So very a lot of trading, but not that much open interest. And then second, the micros at the CME, again, tremendous volume, but not much open interest, especially if you compare it to the E-mini S&P contract. The E-mini has roughly 20 times the open interest of the micro. And again, I think that reflects this difference between institutional and retail trading. Again, looking at the micros in more detail, this is not entirely a retail contract, but it's clearly designed for retail because the size is so much smaller than even the E-minis. And what we saw here was there was a very rapid adoption when they were first launched, but it looks like it sort of slowed down a bit towards the end of last year and then picked up in the first quarter. It'd be an interesting question to see if this is going to become a contract that continues to grow, or if we've effectively reached a market saturation at this point. I should add, by the way, it's not a zero-sum game. Overall, the addition of the micros to the E-minis has actually expanded the market as a whole. Now, institutional. Here's an example of a contract that is kind of invisible to retail, but is incredibly important to institutional. And I chose this one just to give you kind of a case study of some of the factors that are affecting trading trends on the institutional side of the market. This chart is showing the Euro Stoxx 50 futures. On the left, the traditional price return futures, which we know very well, which is the number one equity index contract in Europe. On the right is the volume of interest for the total return futures based on the Euro Stoxx 50. Those contracts include that price return, but they also include in the pricing and in the return on those futures, the dividends that are paid on the underlying stocks, as well as financing costs that are embedded in a lot of the trading. In effect, the total return futures are replicating the returns that investors would get from a total return swap. So really what you're seeing here is people taking positions from the OTC markets in Europe for equity swaps and migrating them into central clearing through a trade entry service in the form of these total return futures. Volume has been growing, but it's nowhere near what you see with the regular futures market. On the other hand, open interest is enormous, relative. It's roughly about two-thirds the size of what you see with the traditional futures. And that's because effectively what people are doing is they're warehousing their risk at the clearinghouse. And by the way, I should add that if you look back farther in time, this started at very small levels and growing very steadily over time. And in fact, we've now seen that ICE has added a similar product to its lineup in London with the total return futures on the FTSE 100. Interest rate futures and options. So just a quick overview here. We saw a tremendous reduction in activity during the pandemic year when interest rates went to zero. Just wasn't much appetite for interest rate risk. That has really rebounded. And in fact, first quarter numbers in volume hit a record level. Open interest hasn't fully recovered. It's kind of bouncing around, but there's some very positive signs on that side as well. This chart is just showing you first quarter of 2023 compared to a year ago. And it helps understand where in the overall interest rate futures markets we're seeing growth of activity. And very quickly, you can see it's in the STIRS, the short-term interest rate complex, where you see that in both, well, actually pretty much across the board, Europe, Latin America, mainly B3, and North America. And you see it also in both options and futures. Top contracts by volume. On this one, I really want to flag the line one, the first row, the three-month SOFR futures at the CME. So this is, you know, one of those situations where if anything had gone wrong, it would be headline news, but nothing did. CME pulled off probably the largest transition ever in the history of the industry from one contract, the euro dollar, you know, which had been the sort of the mainstay of its business for a very long time, transitioned over into the secured overnight financing rate, I believe it stands for, the SOFR. It took quite a while. It was a complicated process, but they've pulled it off. And now SOFR futures have replaced euro dollars as a single most heavily traded interest rate futures contract in the world. And I should add, by the way, the options are right behind it. There was definitely a bit of a lag there at first. There was challenging to move open interest and volume from euro dollar options to SOFR, but they've pulled it off. And I think at this point, the vindication of that was the fact that in March, they set record levels of volume in those contracts, mainly because of that instability in the U.S. banking sector. Want to also look at Fed fund futures because, you know, here's a contract just blew up in March. You can see that blue bar on the far right just took off again because of all that uncertainty about what the Fed is going to do next. On the one hand, you've got inflation, you know, questions about whether how persistent that is. On the other side, you've got, wow, we've got a real problems in the banking sector. Everyone's wondering just how deep they go. And how do you deal with that uncertainty? You go into the futures market and you trade these contracts. Meanwhile, Euribor. So Euribor, obviously the hugely important contract in Europe. Here we saw a big jump in volume, but I noticed an open interest easing from where it was last year. This is probably because last year was particularly high because of all the uncertainty about the UK budget. I won't go into that. That's now in the rearview mirror, but I think that was an indication where people were taking on a lot of open interest in order to kind of hedge those risks. Briefly on bonds, this is the last part before we get into commodities. Here's the top contracts by volume. What stands out here is that the contracts that grew the most were at the short end of the curve, specifically the two-year Treasury note options and futures at CME and the shots futures and options at Eurex. That's where we saw a really big resurgence in the level of trading and in the level of open interest. Bond futures overall at Eurex, rising volume, falling open interest. I don't have any particularly good insights on this, but it's as you can see from the numbers, volume really picked up in the first quarter, whereas open interest went to a two-year low. If I had to guess, I would say probably people were taking risk off in these markets, but we'll see how that plays out over time. All right. That brings us to commodity derivatives. And the first slide really summarizes some key themes. What we're going to do is we'll have Guy now take over the mic, as it were, go through these themes that he sees across those markets, and then we'll dive into energy, metals, and agriculture. Guy, over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Will. I mean, certainly interesting times, as it has been for seemingly a very long time. in financial markets, but I think for, particularly in terms of commodities, there's an extraordinary amount of sort of fairly major factors and themes going on, both in a positive and a negative way, that are impacting market volumes. And of course, some of those are applicable to the financial futures world as well, but commodities often are impacted slightly differently. And I've sort of summarized five of them. I'm not saying there's only five, but there's five sort of big ones that are going on in terms of sort of the data we've just seen and what it impacts it. And one of them, and I think it's sort of one that actually probably doesn't get as much attention as it should, is the whole sort of futures versus swaps conundrum, because futures are much more visible. You know, the data we've just seen is about exchange traded derivatives, but in commodities and indeed financials as well, there's a lot of swap positions which are not as visible but are still there. And very often, particularly in commodities, those swaps could be literally exactly the same as a future. All that's different is the clearing mechanism. And that's really, I think, not that well understood in commodities in particular, because a lot of people focus on the CFTC commitment of traders support, for example, as a sort of benchmark for speculative positioning, which only includes futures. And therefore, you're sort of hopeful and reliant on that segment of the market being representative of the whole, which sometimes it is and sometimes it isn't. But so that's always been a sort of a thing within commodities. But at the moment, it's, I would say, particularly acute, because there has been sort of a fairly long running trend over the past 10 years with changes in bank capital, regulatory treatment of commodity derivatives and swaps in particular, that have gradually been pushing swap exposure off bank balance sheets and into the futures market. So you know, a stark example of this would say be WTI crude, where if you think back to 2008, when everyone was talking about the world's going to run out of oil, and you look at the open interest level on that WTI future, you know, I think the COT report had net non-commercials net length about 125,000 lots or so at the absolute peak. And then sort of 10 years later, when you essentially had a 10-year bear market in crude, we had a bit of a rally from like $30 to $40. And that same commitment of traders report was showing net commercial length of plus 500,000 lots. Now, of course, just intuitively, you know, it cannot possibly be the case that after 10 years of a bear market, you have four times as much speculative length as the absolute sentiment peak. But what that was really demonstrating very, very clearly was sort of a very strong shift in positions being moved off of bank balance sheets in the form of swaps and onto the exchange. The point of that is the positions were already there. It's just the visibility of them changed. So it wasn't new money coming into commodities. It was simply changing how it was placed in the market. That's sort of been a sort of a fairly long-running theme, pushing, if you like, open interest up, bring things into futures. And it's not a cliff edge. That's the other point I would make. And there's also been some recent changes a few years ago in Canada, a similar effect, but existing swaps were always grandfathered. So it's only as swap terms roll off do they come into futures. So it's not like you have one day, everyone moves their positions into the futures market. So it, very much a long-running theme. However, over the last year or so, because of what we've seen in markets, whether it's nickel, whether it's gas, power, you know, obviously we've seen utterly extraordinary moves in incredibly short periods of time. And whether it's futures or swaps, where in futures we call it margining, in swaps we call it posting collateral, it's the same thing. Ultimately, that when the market moves against you, even if it's a hedged physical position, i.e. it's a liquidity issue, not a solvency issue, you have to put up that money. And if you cannot put up that money, your either position has to be covered by the clearing broker or they'll close it out in the market for you. And in a futures space, there's a lot less flex in the system. You know, the ultimate clearinghouse doesn't have the capacity to negotiate with you. Clearing brokers don't necessarily have the money. If you don't have the money, you can't put it up, the position is closed out. In swaps, whilst it should still be the same, the reality is that if you had an extraordinary move in a very short space of time, which is exactly what we've had last year, the margining conversation is a private phone call between who holds that position and their swap counterparty that is not visible to the market. And if And it's in the judgment of the swap dealer whether or not they want to push that client into default or perhaps wait 24 hours to get the money. And invariably, the latter is obviously more palatable. The fundamental problem is we live in a real-time risk management world, and we have a T+1 global banking system. And those two are actually just not compatible in the type of market environment we saw, not without holding levels of excess liquidity at all times, which would clearly be unreasonable. And so that theme, and you're seeing particularly, I say, acutely in energy, is encouraging positions off exchange from physical, from the physical world and into swap exposure. So that's a sort of a negative impact of what's been going on recently. And we see across, pretty much all physical commodities, whoever you talk to, whether it's refining companies, cotton consumers, sugar, anything, the duration of time that the physical world is hedging, whether it's consumption or production, it has shrunken dramatically. And that's simply because the liquidity risk of a long-term hedge is something that they actually can't handle and don't have the liquidity lines in place to cover. The net result of that, of course, is it means greater volatility in markets, lower levels of inventory being held because you have to finance that and margin it. And that kind of creates this sort of, vicious circle in terms of less buffer in the physical market and higher volatility. So that's a pretty massive theme that's sort of always ongoing, I guess. It's certainly not a static one. Changes all the time, but it can be really, really important, and it certainly is at the moment. Second big theme is sort of the idea of commodities as an asset class, and I won't go into that now because I think the next slide we talk a little bit more about that. But it's sort of who are the people who, apart from the producers, consumers who are always there, if you like, the physical world of commodities never goes away. But who are the incremental derivative participants, and what is their profile? That's changed a lot over time as well. We'll talk about that a bit more. Third theme, interest rates, volatility. This is not just specific to commodities at all, but it has had a very, very significant impact. The typical commodity producer is not a luxury goods company. They are not producing, with like 60% EBITDA margins. It's quite the opposite. Most commodities are a scale-driven game. It's about volume. Operating margins are relatively low. And when you go from a world that is basically debt is free, volatility is low, and things are sort of relatively stable to the world we are now in, where money is certainly not free, and volatility is high, the sort of extra cost of being in the physical business has just totally changed in the last 12 months. It used to be the case, holding commodity inventory, again, could be copper, could be cocoa, doesn't matter, just holding inventory was cheap. Now it's very expensive. That's the critical point. And in a world of, like I said, certainly not industry going through super normal profits, most commodity companies are always trying to limit their exposure to price risk, not the other way around, because commodities are typically too volatile. But it's fundamentally changed the cost of moving material around, holding material, and that's true of everyone. It doesn't matter whether you're the producer, sort of the trade house moving it from somewhere, the consumer, do you want to buy, do you want to fill up the stock cupboard or not? And it seriously changed everything, the cost throughout the supply chain. And ultimately, it will ultimately push commodity prices up because these costs are effectively a cost of production and will ultimately feed through. And obviously what has been driving some of the inflation we've seen. And very strongly connects to that is the next theme, which I call geopolitics, but actually probably the end of globalization, or actually the sort of, if you like, the rise of decoupling, you could argue. And of course, the pandemic was also a massive cause of this. Obviously major supply chain bottlenecks. You could have a huge surplus of a commodity in one place and a chronic deficit of the same commodity in another, but there wasn't the supply chain capacity to move that that there used to be. You know, commodities always find, you know, more, reason I find them interesting, they have extra dimensions than most other financial products. They have, you know, dimension of location, time, you know, holding, you know, having a lot of iron ore in a landlocked mine in Africa is not the same thing as having the same amount of iron ore outside the gate of a steel mill. They have completely different values. But first the pandemic and then the Ukrainian invasion has done, and actually, to be honest, it was already kind of heading that direction anyway, with sort of the US tariffs during the Trump administration and so on. So the globalization, I think, had already peaked, but first the pandemic and then the Ukrainian situation have just accelerated that. What that's caused is obviously complete breakdown in a lot of the correlations between different products. And I think probably also going back to the financial futures charts, I think, you know, the days of, you know, just the S&P 500 simply being a global proxy for equities, probably over. You know, we saw it in the pandemic, you know, one minute China's locked down, the US is fine. You know, a few quarters later, it's completely the opposite way around. I mean, you know, if you'd gone back 5 years and suggested you could have that level of growth differential between two largest economies in the world, you'd have been called crazy. So we've seen utterly extreme and extraordinary macroeconomic divergences in different regions. Probably still, if we're honest, sort of seeing the ripple effects of those changes. But it kind of applies to commodities as well, in that, and I think more persistent, and gas is the obvious example to focus in on, probably one of the harder ones to move around. It's just the gas, European gas market is not the same as the gas market in China. It's not the same as the gas market in the US. They're not the same commodity, is the point. They might have gas in the name, but they are not the same thing. And that is a major issue for a lot of commodity producers, because generally, a hedge is never perfect, but you accept the basis risk or the potential divergence from the physical thing you're talking about, because the benefit of the extra liquidity and the lower cost of hedging offsets that. In a world where you get this significantly increased dislocation, the liquidity benefit of, say Henry Hub natural gas future in the US is not going to compensate you for potentially what might be going on in the European gas market. Of course, there always was potential to decouple a bit, but in general, crude oil is crude oil, or, you know, it would have been very unusual for gas prices to double in one region and halve in another. But we're now in a world where that's not only possible, but very feasible, maybe even likely. And so that, commodity producers, consumers who need a hedge that is going to correlate, that's going to actually open up new markets. That you're going to sort of see less concentration in the previous benchmarks. Wheat is another great example. You know, it used to be sort of wheat. Yes, there are little variations here and there, but ultimately wheat was wheat. And no matter where you were in the world, Chicago wheat was probably going to be a reasonable hedge. That's probably no longer true, or not sufficiently true. And so that opens up more interest in different wheat futures in different markets. But to Will's point, that's not zero sum either. That actually, the more different types of wheat there are that have liquid derivative markets, the differentials between those two markets can themselves become a tradable product. So, sort of what we call ARB activity or inter-commodity spreads, these are, I think, factors that help drive the overall growth of trading activity in commodities at the moment. And then finally, the decarbonization agenda, which it really is an enormous underlying theme. I think the strength of that is evidenced by the fact that, despite what we've seen over the last 12 months or so, energy crisis, cost of living crisis, and so on, that decarbonization agenda and pressure, both sort of from whether it's media or actually legislative, hasn't gone away, and probably therefore isn't going to go away. If it's not going to go away in an energy crisis, it's not going to go away at all. And that has very, very significant implications for different commodities. So those are the big themes. Hopefully I haven't missed anything out too major. But if we move on to the next slide, the one I didn't really talk about that much was, well, who are the sort of speculators? Who are speculators in commodities? And that, again, has evolved a lot. There's always been speculators in commodities. To be frank, started it in the 1970s, but obviously gone before that. But yeah, the turtle traders, I guess, most famous ones, the CTAs were started in that environment. It's still, going strong today. And momentum strategies have always actually been a fairly major component within commodities. But then it sort of evolved, probably most strongly around the start of the new century, where, I think obviously a lot of it was driven by the Chinese super cycle, the perception that commodities were just going to go up and up and up because of the Chinese super cycle. And therefore, investors wanted exposure. And, it's one of the oddities, I think, I always find in sort of pension fund world, that sort of, being long things is deemed to be ethically sound. Being short things is morally dubious. I don't know why it is that way. It just is. It's only short selling in equities that gets banned. You never have a congressional investigation when energy becomes cheap. It's when it sort of goes to $150. So there are certain things which should seem to be defined as positives to go up and negatives. But pension funds typically don't ever like to be short something, or often mandate prevents them ever being short something. And so you kind of need commodities to be going up to make that interesting for them. And a sort of equity-like approach was taken initially, just passive long-only indices, what is now S&P GSCI and the Bloomberg Commodity Index being the main ones. They weren't necessarily those names originally, but those are still the two main ones. The issue with that, as sort of pension funds kind of learned, is that there were two problems. One is, commodities don't always go up, which is one problem. And secondly, they have a thing called contango, which again is not something that most financial futures people would necessarily be as familiar with. And for the majority of the time, they are a negative carry asset. So that approach was then sort of refined, as it were, to go, I guess, what they now call enhanced beta products, i.e. they're still long only, still passive, but the index rules have sort of inbuilt optimization techniques to reduce the potential costs of contango. And at a very simple level, if there's a big contango, you roll out along the curve, and if it's backwardated, you come to the front at its most basic level. And those things have been have outperformed sort of the first iteration commodity indices for sure. What then happened, the evolution, what was the next iteration of that, was because we were still in an environment where commodities weren't going up. And of course, if you want to be passive long only something, you still need it to be going up in some way. Just simply losing less money isn't that attractive. So risk premium strategies sort of started to move into commodities. Now, when I first started my career, those things were called factor-based investing in equities. And again, it was a fairly clear concept that you try and isolate particular factors, whether it's high dividend yield, value, whatever it's momentum, screen the market, you create a market neutral basket. So it does have to be long and short things, but isolating exposure to that particular factor. Those things actually done really, really well in the financial space, whether it's equities, FX, volatility. Again, because our post-financial crisis, we were in a 0% interest rate world. Things were very, very stable. And all these risk premium strategies were designed to create positive carry. So in the volatility space, that essentially means selling implied volatility against being long realized, because it's typically implied trades at premium over time. In bonds, it means, I'm long junk bonds or high yield, as they prefer to be called, and I'm short Japanese governments. in FX, you know, long emerging market currencies, short the yen, that sort of thing. Of course, that all works fine. And most carry trades are a bit like this, is they work fine most of the time, you know, go up by the stairs and down by the elevator, as they call it. So they are prone to you know, sharp drops, typically, because they are ultimately based on sort of correlation. But because I think these strategies have been so successful in financials and demand for them was so high, and I think particularly from pension funds, because they had the appearance of sort of relatively low volatility, you know, positive carry instruments that you could buy. So even though the strategy is both long and short, they were embedded in a certificate which you own. So you actually owned a thing. You weren't ever short something directly. You just owned a thing, had exposure to something, being short something. That's how pension funds justified it. It came into commodities, and there's a few sort of different variety of factors involved with that. Probably the, one of the bigger ones, though, is you know, this concept of those the first two indices I've just described, whereby the short leg of this sort of factor would be that sort of passive long-only index, the first iteration, and the long version is this enhanced beta. So you essentially take, I'm long enhanced beta, I'm short beta, my net position I'm going to call alpha in inverted commas, and that's a product I'm going to sell. And that again did very, very well for a period of time, but like a lot of things, you know, the world changed, you know, when the pandemic hit. You got huge dislocations, huge breakdowns in you know, in correlation and previously existing relationships. So funnily enough, commodities actually relatively did pretty well. And the reason for that is a long carry strategy in commodities, typically because of the tendency for curves to be in a contango, you're typically short the front, long the back of the futures curve. And in a sharp dropping world, which essentially was, you know, that sort of the beginning of the pandemic, you basically make money, decent money. Whereas in say FX, you're invariably, you know, you're long risk, you're long emerging markets, short US treasuries. In bonds, you're long high yield, you're short US treasury. You know, it's, there's an inherent sort of long, sort of pro risk in, characteristic of positive carry strategy in those markets. In commodities, it's the same. Sorry, the opposite, I should say.
Got it. Good point.
So that's kind of how the market's evolved in terms of sort of the sort of major strategies. So a lot less sort of passive length activity, a lot more sort of RV strategies. But the other critical thing is the right sort of the dominance of quantitative investment styles has become really quite acute. And again, not only factor in commodities, we've been seeing in equities for ages, you know, that investment styles are now replicated in style ETFs. You know, you don't need to pay a fund manager to run an income fund. You just have a dividend screen ETF, you know, it comes at a much lower cost. Don't have to pay anyone a bonus. And you know, it's priced extremely competitively in the market. And to a certain extent, commodities you know, have seen that as well, you know, increased amount of quantitative styles. I'm not talking about just CTAs at all, risk premium. You know, it's not just a cost issue, although that is a big driver. It is to a certain extent a regulatory issue. You know, the increased requirements to document and have a record of your investment decision process. Why did you do what you do? And actually, if you have a quantitative approach, that's really easy to demonstrate. In a qualitative approach, it potentially can be quite burdensome. You're trying to explain why you felt something was, the position was appropriate on one day and not the next. So that continues to be a major feature. Interestingly, over the last 6 months, we've seen a very, very significant increase in hiring and sort of, I guess what you call a tooling up of commodity teams within a lot of major funds, a lot of whom were either had previously been in commodities and exited, or yeah, had actually historically always been primarily either equity or financials focused. And the reasons behind that have been partly because the events of the last 12 months have made a lot of, I'm talking again on the discretionary side of things, have made people realize that commodities can sometimes really, really matter. And if you don't have anyone in your organization trading those markets and understand those markets, you don't actually know what's going on. And in a world where commodities impact everything, and they don't always, this is the point, you know, a lot of times over the last 10, 20 years, you could argue commodities haven't mattered. But in a world like we've seen the last 12 months, what's happening in the commodities market dramatically impacts, frankly, the solvency of a lot of the investments and equity investments that people have made and probably not even considering what's going on in the commodity market. So there's definitely been a sort of strategic decision by a lot of funds, it seems, to be in these markets. That's a different question from how much capital you allocate, but simply wanting to have the expertise within the firm. But because I guess sort of the dominance of the quantitative style, if you like, in attracting assets in financials over the past 20 years, it has all come really, I guess, with a quantitative bias that could be systematic. But actually, I would say probably the biggest growth I've seen over the last 6 months has been from discretionary funds who will have what you say, like a quantitative framework. So they're not necessarily systematic in terms of their actions, but they still have a very, very strong quantitative basis to their styles. And we've even seen some systematic funds starting to set up discretionary units inside of those systematic funds in order to achieve some diversification. Because there's only so many ways you can sort of come up with quant models on the same data. So that's sort of like a fairly sort of high level backdrop. Well, I don't think we can move, I guess, onto sort of.
All right. So we're going to go through energy, metals, then ag. I'll be very brief so that Guy can talk about his slides. But in a nutshell, when you look at the top contracts by volume, you see several micros. And I've included in this chart the size. So you can see that, for example, the contracts from the Moscow Exchange or the Indian exchanges are 10 or 100 times smaller than the benchmark contracts that trade in New York and London. Now, this is where it gets interesting. And take a look at nat gas. This is one of those commodities that has been really in focus over the last year or so, not only because of the invasion of Ukraine, which then led to a huge disruption in European imports of gas from Russia, but also because of the ways in which this has shifted global flows of gas. So, Guy, this, I think, is a snapshot from your Nanalytics platform. Mm-hmm.
Yes,
so in brief, what are we looking at?
So actually, so gas, I think it's a wonderful market and fantastic history, always very interesting. And actually, going back to sort of the history of it, gas is probably the market that was singularly responsible for the rise in swap activity. I would say almost created that centrally cleared concept within commodities, because previously, commodity derivatives activity was dominated by futures pits. And what changed was Enron.
Enron, exactly.
And for the, everyone's always wise after the event, myself included, but obviously what Enron really did was it made people realize that counterparty risk was a thing. Prior to that, no one ever thought about it, to be blunt. And that then led to, much, much higher demand for centrally cleared activity as opposed to obviously bilateral trades where there was obviously going to be counterparty risk. And because a centrally cleared swap is just essentially the same thing as exchange traded derivative, it's just doesn't have vertically integrated clearing with execution. And for a variety of reasons, the sort of executing through the NYMEX pit in gas was not always favored by certain market participants. There was a very, very rapid switch of trading activity away from the NYMEX pit towards essentially centrally cleared swaps on Clearpool. So essentially still cleared at NYMEX, etc. But a major change in the exchange venue. I did this analysis years ago, and I don't even know if I could do it again today. I don't know where I got the data, but it was something like the market share of NYMEX futures in Henry Hub went from something like 85% to 20% between 01 and 05, something like that. And, you know, the reverse happened with Henry Hub cleared swaps. Why is that relevant? Well, it's relevant because the point I was making earlier in that what's visible to the market is the future activity, and what's not visible is the swaps. Now, if you go from a world where the commitment traders report is telling you what 85% of the market is doing, it's highly, highly likely it's going to be representative. When it's showing you what 20% of the market's doing, highly unlikely to be representative. And so when I worked in gas markets, this was sort of the realization I had that actually we weren't going to be able to use the commitment traders report in the way which sort of pre-2000 you could do, because the world had just fundamentally changed in that the nature of the liquidity pool had changed. That was one aspect of it. The other is that, you know, I don't want to say the world was simpler back then, but, you know, in the old days, in inverted commas, days of turtle traders, you know, it was a little cleaner as to who was a speculator. Tiger Global Management was definitely a speculator. Oil and gas producers were definitely commercials. Swap dealers were definitely swap dealers. But as sort of we moved in by about 2005, you know, banks, swap dealers were trying to become hedge funds. They were turning themselves into trade houses, trading out, running prop books. The lines became blurred. And so the whole kind of classification of trade thing is huge in these reports, because by definition, all futures have a net exposure of zero. For every buyer, there's a seller. So it's really critical if things have been categorized correctly. And the whole sort of futures versus swaps thing is really important, because if a speculator accesses the market directly through futures, they're visible. If they access that market through a swap, then what hits the market is the hedging activity of the swap dealer, which is obviously going to be categorized in that category, not what drives that hedging in the swap. So it's a major thing to consider. And that's what I realize is that in order to sort of understand how speculators are positioned, we need to come at it from a different perspective and think about, well, what is it attracts speculative capital to a market or repels it? And that's not going to be, it's not a case of looking at a report which essentially you don't know, is it representative or is it not, you don't know. It's like trying to solve a single equation with two unknowns. It's actually not possible. We need to think about, you know, just base more fundamental concepts such as, you know, speculators trying to be long things which go up and short things which go down, which sounds very facile. But if you look at the WTI commitment traders report over the last 20 years, it's not consistent with that basic concept, which tells you what the problem is. It's not just about price direction, it's about volatility. Risk is managed very often on a VAR type basis. So it's how it moves, not necessarily just which direction it moves. So it's about risk adjusted returns. It's understanding that markets are fractal. So it could be uptrending in one time frame and downtrending in another. But liquidity is going to be inversely proportionate to that. And so sort of basically developed these models over the years, which really sort of designed to try and, if you like, reverse engineer what we think speculative positioning is purely by applying this algorithm to the market price action and estimating it accordingly. So that is that bottom panel. That is our net speculative estimate. And it's not based on commitment traders report at all, just to be very, very clear. It's not an adjustment of the commitment traders report. That's the output from our model.
It's your black box.
Sorry, say again,
It's your black box.
Yes, in essence, yes. So that's that net specs position at the bottom. And then the middle panel is what we call an analytics net demand. Now, what is that? Well, this is sort of a tool we developed to essentially create a barometer, if you like, of market microstructure activity. Because obviously, as futures pits disappeared, what hasn't changed in markets is the importance of psychology and fear and greed, or whatever you want to call it. Those things still drive markets. Forced selling, forced buying, being stopped out, fear of miscarriage, all these things are still as important. The weapons of war have changed, But psychology is still as important in markets as it ever was. However, yeah, when you're in a futures pit in the mid 80s and you see some guy sweating profusely, red in the face, trying to buy everything he can, you know what that means. He's got a problem. In today's world, that sort of same action is being executed by an algorithm, probably breaking down that order into single lot transactions. And it obviously you can't see it physically in the same way, but so you've got to get that information, market color in a different way. And that is actually analyzing all that market microstructure data at a very, very granular level and then re-aggregating to understand what happens. Now, of course, the only thing this can look at is obviously what's happening on exchange on the screen. So it's important to know, what are you not seeing? Obviously, we're not seeing swap exposure. We're not seeing block trade, block futures trade that gets posted and cleared. That happened off the screen. It can only pick up the activity that's happening on the screen, which is largely algorithmic these days. So I always think it's important to know what it isn't as much as what it is, but it's a piece of information. You know, it's aggregating vast amounts of data into a single score. And we, and how do we interpret it? Well, again, there's no single rule for that. Sometimes we see this data correlating with price action. Sometimes we see it not correlating with price action. But in general, the way we always sort of try to think about it is, well, we're trying to look for trends and then look for something that's changing. So for example, if we go and look at the Q4 2021, which is sort of the left-hand sort of bar, you can see how that sort of market sort of has that sort of sharp move down, sort of November, December, then analytics data correlates with that pretty tightly. And what we often look for in this kind of data is extremities, outliers. So you have this big red spike down. And an extreme bar in an analytics data is quite often an indicator of capitulation, as in stop loss driven activity. So, and whenever stop losses are triggered, they immediately cross the spread. It's going to show up in transaction aggression readings. And so it's very often the case that these outlier bars mark the end of something, that capitulative moment. Not always, but, it happens often enough.
Right.
What's interesting, again, if you look at sort of that middle period, 2022, Q2, Q3, when positioning was much, much flatter on our estimates, because, people have been shaken out of the length that built up in the second quarter, actually you see the general sort of size of those analytics bars much, much lower, as you'd expect. If positioning's lower, activity's lower, these readings are lower. But then those same bars over the last, from the beginning of this year, effectively starting to expand quite significantly. And when I look at it right now, what does it mean to me right now? Well, actually, we had a very, very large short position build up that on our estimates peaked in the early part of this year, the net short. And the short has actually been covering, even though price action has not been that positive. Largely, I'd imagine, driven by a pickup in volatility. So, position sizes tend to be reduced as volatility picks up. But, even very recently, 5 days ago or so, we see, this very, very strong negative bar on an analytics data, which actually was the chart's a little bit too long to rebash. It looks like that was the short-term low in price on that day. So it'd be interesting what happened. But these are what I call, they're like nowcasts. They're not forecasts. They're barometers of what's happening.
I'm going to interrupt for one sec because there's quite a lot to go through is beyond this, and running a little short on time. I especially want to get to nickel because it's an interesting story. Mm-hmm. Very briefly, the other side of the Atlantic, nat gas. Now, this is just the FIA's data on volume and open interest. I decided to take a look at the TTF contract on ICE and go back in time to get that historical perspective we just heard on NYMEX. And what I noticed about the TTF contract is it really went from, being an incredibly lightly traded contract to becoming one of the really important benchmarks of the global gas market. And that was, you know, a pretty steep rise until 2021-ish, when, you know, things started to turn. People got, there were a lot of different reasons for this. And then we see a huge drop off with the invasion of Ukraine. And you might think, well, wouldn't that actually increase the amount of trading, given people need to hedge? Well, it would, except the volatility went up so high, the margin requirements really crowded some people out of the market. And what I think is particularly important is that as volatility has come down, prices have come down, we've seen a rebound in trading. Open interest is still well below that peak that we saw in 2021, but it remains a very significant contract. And I think it's worth pointing that out because it is, as I said, it's become one of the most important benchmarks. It also highlights something, Guy, that you mentioned much earlier on, which is that one benchmark just doesn't do the job anymore. Henry Hub alone by itself, if you're dealing with price action in Europe or Asia Pacific, and you need to see what the prices are, you need a different benchmark. And I think this illustrates that. Now jumping to metals. I decided to focus here on just
that TTF chart. I think it's probably a very clear example of a shift of exposure from futures to swaps.
That may well be the case. The
dynamic I was talking about would probably explain the decline in OI.
It probably is. I think also some people just exited the market. Those utilities just could not afford to hedge at those prices. I would say, by the way, one other thing you don't see here, which is worth, which have done in previous webinars. So TTF was, and still is, the main European benchmark, but it's not the only one. I mean, you've seen a definite pickup in trading in some of the other benchmarks, such as the PEG benchmark, the TAG, and there's one or two others, I can't remember them, I apologize. But that's really an indication that people are beginning to look at that basis risk that you mentioned before. So metals, just focusing on the industrial metals. You know, I know precious are very interesting, very precious to a lot of people, but I wanted to focus on industrial metals. This chart shows you the ranking by volume. Again, I put in the size so you can see it. The Chinese exchanges in volume terms dominate this market. And even in open interest terms, and including even with that size, that is a real source of price discovery, if not risk transfer, for the global metals market. Now, zeroing in on nickel, which went through a really extraordinary period. Guy, can you talk about this one? But again, I've got to say, we are running a little tight on time.
Yeah, I'll try and speed up. So, I mean, nickel, without rehashing exactly what happened, is a clear example of the negative impact on volumes that occurred from some of these criteria. Obviously, the market was closed for a period of time. You know, the margin requirements that are now in place on nickel are, you know, multiples of what they were previously. And you can just quite clearly see from that analytics data and sort of the all structural change since the second quarter of last year that we've seen in terms of market activity and volumes. You know, I would say, you know, it's not because necessarily it was nickel, it is that kind of issue of real-time risk management and T+1 banking system. Nickel is where it got exposed most significantly. I think, you know, in terms of just very, very briefly, definitely, you know, metals, base metals are very much at the heart of the decarbonization agenda. Copper for, you know, networks, it used to be very much about Chinese residential construction was a driver, but now the decarbonization agenda is very much more for copper at the moment. Battery materials, of which nickel is one, a lot of lithium. And so on, even aluminium to a certain extent, you know, much more important component of electric vehicles. So metals are a critical part of it, but, you know, iron ore, I think, is a particularly interesting contract. I think you've sort of got a...
Yeah, we'll come to that in a bit.
Okay, sure. I'll talk about that in a minute. But yes, the only issue at the moment on, I guess, probably NME metals in particular, it's very much a physically dominated market. So it's very susceptible to those issues that we've discussed around, you know, the cost of hedging inventory.
So, you know, China is interesting, but it's difficult to access for many players. And therefore, when we talk about metals trading that most of the people on this call, most FI members are dealing with, it's really LME and COMEX, which is, you know, the old commodity exchange part of the CME group. So I decided to put here just the contracts on these exchanges, so we can sort of compare what's happening kind of since that nickel incident. In other words, did people say, oh, right, LME is a problem, I'm just move my trading to New York instead? Well, not exactly. And I think you do see a pickup in volume in some of the counterpart contracts in New York, but they're still quite a bit smaller. Nevertheless, this is a trend that we could keep on watching. Particularly, I think the aluminum or aluminium contract, whichever one prefers, is seeing some very rapid growth in the contract, but from a very low base. And I'm going to just jump ahead to China. I'll just talk about it very briefly. Although it is, again, somewhat off limits to the rest of the world, it is interesting to see just how diverse the offerings are. It's not just copper and aluminum. It's not just crude oil and gasoline. It's an incredibly wide range of products. As you can see here, there's a whole set of futures based on chemicals, for example. And then also a whole bunch of products that are based on industrial materials like glass, lumber, wood pulp, and that sort of thing. And what is really interesting to me about the China story is we've known for a long time there's tremendous volume, but a lot of that was really retail, very speculative. What I've noticed over the last, last two or three years is that open interest has been rising in three of these groups: chemicals, oil and oil seeds, and ferrous. By the way, oil in that case is not crude oil. I'm talking about the edible oils, mainly palm oil. So if I see open interest rising, that means people are not just day trading. They're, taking on positions because they're planning to hold that position over time, which indicates we may be seeing some type of but greater participation by the actual producers and consumers of those commodities. So what are those commodities, to be specific? So here's just a quick list. I got to be honest with you. I had to go back to my chemistry textbook to figure out what these things actually are. This is largely out of sight for those of us who are based in Chicago or Amsterdam or London, but it is an incredibly large market. And in its own way, it's quite innovative because the futures on these chemicals, these petrochemicals, they don't exist anywhere else in the world. And so I have to believe these are really important sources of price discovery for everyone who is involved in the supply chain for both feeding those chemicals into China or participating in that manufacturing or buying the products that are coming out. Steel complex, again, a huge sector of trading activity in China. It's not just steel rebar. It's also the iron ore, which is the raw material, and a whole bunch of other materials that go into the steelmaking process to produce, for example, stainless steel. And again, we're seeing open interest trending higher, even though volume is relatively stable, which again suggests to me that that market is beginning to mature. We're starting to see more actual hedging activity. So I said China is mostly off limits, except for people that are willing to go through the process of setting an onshore entity or perhaps working through a local broker. There is, however, a way to stay in kind of the offshore world and still get exposure to that steel complex and to the larger Chinese economy. And that's the iron ore complex at the Singapore Exchange. When I say complex, it's actually iron ore options and futures. And there's multiple grades, although the one that's most important is 62% grade. And what we've seen here is that volume has hit the record level. Open interest is high and staying high. It strikes me, and this is something I've talked about before, that market is now becoming not just relevant for producers, people are actually shipping iron ore to China, but also to any number of financial interests that are seeing as a way to take a position on how strong is the Chinese economy, how strong is the construction sector, the housing sector. This is a way to kind of add that to one's trading strategy. Agriculture futures. I promise I'll get one last slide from Guy. I won't even talk about this one just to give you all a sense of what's going on in China. Outside of China, which is, again, what's happening here, mostly dominated by contracts traded in Chicago with a notable exception of line row 9, which is the milling wheat futures at Euronext. To your point, Guy, people are looking at basis risk. That's the primary wheat contract for Europe and extremely relevant given the impact on the production of wheat in Ukraine and that part of the world, and how much that's been disrupted. Cocoa markets. So this is the last example I want to talk about because cocoa to me is such an interesting story. Let's call this, I'm going to try to be funny here, the dessert phase of our webinar. We're seeing a record level of activity, a rising level of trading activity, a rising level of interest. Something is happening in cocoa markets. Seems to be mainly driven by tight supplies. But even though this is kind of a niche market, it's really an interesting story to see it rising so much compared to the rest of the ag sector. And now back to you, Guy, for our closing note on cocoa.
Thank you. So obviously, this is the same sort of analytics and net spec data, but just for the New York contract. So yeah, I think you know what's driving sort of increased interest in cocoa at the moment. Probably two factors. One is it's been kind of in the doldrums for a couple of years, but as we head into an El Nino, there's quite a strong statistical link between basically poor cocoa production and that weather effect. So the expectation is that we're going to head into a supply crunch, which obviously is making prices pick up. That's then attracting, you know, that trend following community, and speculative positioning is starting to build up. It's also a product where you've got essentially two relatively liquid market, both about as liquid as each other, I should say, sort of New York and London. The London one is also
right, good point.
Generally referred to as life. But what's sort of impacting cocoa market in terms of sort of volume and volatility at the moment is another factor, which is these sort of implemented by, I think it was Ivory Coast, so the fair income differential, or was it living income differential, essentially adds it's quite a complicated formula, essentially adds a premium to cocoa produced from certain origins. And the two main ones are Ghana and Ivory Coast, which is really where the bulk of the high quality cocoa in the world comes from. That is applied to physical cocoa in the physical market for those inches. But obviously the future is based not on specifically cocoa right. from its origins. So this is a classic example of a basis risk problem. Obviously futures should converge on spot as they approach expiry is the concept. But if you start to see a breakdown in fungibility, should we call it, in the physical market, then that can kind of be, I don't want to say anarchic, but effectively you can see very significant increases in volatility as you approach right. notice period, because you can get quite major differences in the ultimate physical price of what's being delivered. Versus what's
that's a great point.
So it's and cocoa is an interesting market. It's not actually in any of the main commodity indices though, however, so it has sort of slightly different flow impacts. Just very quickly leaping back to that SGX iron ore, the reason I think it's very interesting is because a lot of quant funds, not everyone's the same, but broadly speaking, as a rule of thumb, having 10 years of price history is a prerequisite in order to be able to analyze it and build a strategy around it, and that's pretty much what we're coming up to in terms of the length of history of the SGX iron ore contract, plus, it meets the liquidity thresholds that people would typically want to have. So we are seeing a significant pickup in interest in that SGX iron ore contract from the
community.
That plus, has been a quite significant increase the last couple of years of ARB activity. So people trading Dalian against SGX because of the dislocations and so on that we've been talking about.
Again, not a zero-sum game. So look, we've come to the end of the webinar. There is one really important question that was asked during the course of this that I do want to address to you. By the way, I'm just putting up here just upcoming webinars, upcoming conferences for those of you still on with us. Question about your point about the data. So you're absolutely right. Commitment to Traders reports, which everyone has relied on for ages, only covers the listed, right? And not those cleared swaps. So the question was, well, what about these SDRs, swap, I don't even know, I think it's called depository, well, I'm not sure what they actually stands for, but essentially it's meant to be a place where you can, where the people who trade swaps are required to report their transactions into, and therefore one should be able to track that swap activity from the SDRs, no?
Yes, people are required to report their swap activity, And that's to the same people, the CFTC. So the CFTC have all the information. However, I don't know if it's a legislative rule or an agreement with swap dealers, but they're not allowed to publish an aggregated at the aggregated swap positions, they're not allowed to publicize that. And I guess the reason is it's deemed to be commercially sensitive and could cause market dislocation, disruption. But yeah, the data held by the CFTC is just not public at an aggregated level. Futures data is allowed to be published at an aggregated level.
That's an excellent point. I would say, by the way, I would not be surprised if we saw the CFTC starting to rethink that. I'm not familiar with the rules in that area, to be honest with you. You may be right. It may not. Their hands may be tied. But I think they've already begun publishing reports on cleared interest rate swaps. I think even credit default swaps, because those are much more front and center in the minds of policymakers after the crisis. But maybe in today's environment, given the importance of commodities, the CFTC might take a look at that data and start thinking about ways to disclose more of it without damaging, to your point, without damaging the positions of firms that might actually, you know, have a fairly large share of the market, or their market might be so small that even disclosing a little bit actually makes that those handful of players, it kind of exposes them to kind of a negative market action. Well, look, I'm going to end here. We're quite a bit over time, as a matter of fact. Look, Guy, thank you so much for those insights. Actually, I thought there was some really, really good historic perspective we haven't had in our webinars before. I've been around a long time, but you brought some stuff to light that I'd completely forgotten about or didn't even know. So thank you very, very much for sharing that with us.
No, thanks, Will.
All right. And thanks all. Take care and look forward to our next webinar.